Ja, let me first express my gratitude to Gediminas to gather us here in this unique place in Europe, in this unique town and this unique university. And also the auditorium is quite special, and I'm sure we learn more about the history of the place when we take the tour through the university on Tuesday. Talking about the Humboldt Foundation, I actually had the benefit of being supported by Humboldt twice. First, as a postdoctoral researcher, I had a Theodor Lünen Fellowship, which allowed me to go to the United States and learn about atomic physics and change my field. And then, more than 20 years later, I received a Humboldt Award to go to Germany on a sabbatical. So thanks to the Humboldt Foundation, I always felt the connection between the two countries, United States and Germany. Okay, so let me start with the first scientific talk, which is about spin-orbit coupling. We all know in atomic physics that spin-orbit coupling is responsible for the fine structure of atoms, but the coupling of spin and orbital motion also happens in condensed matter systems. And as many of you know, spin-orbit coupling is often the term in the Hamiltonian, which gives rise to special properties of topological insulators, Majorana fermions and such. And as we have recently shown, spin-orbit coupling can also give rise to supersolids. Spin-orbit coupling is in its most basic form as one-dimensional spin-orbit coupling, couples spin, a spin flip, with momentum transfer, and therefore can be implemented with the tools of atomic physics as a two-photon Raman transition. Or let me repeat, a two-photon Raman transition which flips the spin and transfers momentum couples spin and orbit and is a one-dimensional form of spin-orbit coupling. And when you add spin-orbit coupling to Bose-Einstein condensation, you get a new form of matter, a supersolid, which is still superfluid as a Bose-Einstein condensate, but it has a density modulation, spontaneous density modulation, which fulfills the definition of a solid. So this is just the motivation for spin-orbit coupling. When we create new forms of matter with cold atoms, this is sort of my cartoon of the experiment. We have many cold atoms in an atom trap, and then we use many laser beams, radio frequencies, and microwaves to create a new form of matter. However, there is a powerful extension of, I mean, we're not running out of ideas, we can add many more laser beams, but there is a powerful extension of this method, and this is if those laser beams or radio frequency fields or magnetic fields are time modulated. With time modulation, we can engineer new Hamiltonian, we sometimes call it Floquet engineering, using Floquet's theorem that if you have a rapid modulation, you can often separate the full time evolution of the system into a fast part, which is the micro motion, and often we're not interested in that. But then there is a slow part, often an averaging over the rapid modulation, and it is this slow part or secular motion, which is an effective Hamiltonian we try to create. So let me give you a famous example, and this is the Paul trap for charged particles. So can you trap particles purely with electric fields? Well, if you want to trap a particle, you need an inward force from all directions. The divergence of the force has to be zero, and this violates Maxwell's equations for the electric field. However, if you alternate a quadrupole field, which is now here an inward electric field in the vertical direction, it's repulsive in the horizontal, but then you invert it and you modulate between the two, the time average is not zero as you may naively assume, the time average is a net focusing effect. So this example shows you that if you time modulate, you can do something which you could never do without time modulation. In that case, purely electrostatic trapping of ions, of charged particles, is possible because of time modulation. And actually, when I mentioned in the introduction that spin-orbit coupling has given rise to supersolid behavior of Bose-Einstein condensates, we actually used a time-modulated lattice, but that's not something I want to talk about. So let me come to the new result and the main topic of my talk. This is actually work which was done in discussions with Gediminas, and so I really enjoyed writing a paper together with him. Now, this talk can have many titles. Maybe the most catchy title is, how can you endow or dress a radio frequency photon with adjustable momentum? Or you can call it Floquet engineering of photon recoil. Or you can call it spin-orbit coupling with magnetic forces. And I have to say, this method I want to present to you was clearly motivated to have a way to do spin-orbit coupling without lasers. But I have to also tell you, this is a very transparent scheme where you can fully understand what is the mechanism, what are the features of Floquet engineering. Actually, my students said, now the whole Floquet theory seems simple to me because we have such a transparent example. On the other hand, I also think it has a general appeal because who doesn't want to know how you can take an IF photon, but the IF photon now has momentum, which usually it doesn't. So the whole scheme has two ingredients. It has an oscillating magnetic force, an AC gradient of the magnetic field, and it has an IF spin flip at around 10 megahertz. And now none of them transfers momentum, because here the force is periodic, and an IF photon has such a low frequency that the momentum transfer of the photon is completely negligible. But as I told you, when you modulate, something new can happen, and the combination of those two processes can result in momentum transfer. And this can be, and I want to now explain it in different ways and show you really in an intuitive way the physics behind it. So let's assume we have this oscillating magnetic force, and in between, we have some weak IF pulses. You can assume these are delta function pulses. So if I look now at one part of the atomic amplitude and say, okay, first the atom is in the ground state, it oscillates, but now due to this IF pulse, there is a spin flip. Now the spin flipped amplitude is now seeing a reversed force, and if you look at this magnetic force, you see, wow, here are two cycles of the magnetic shaking which have the same momentum transfer, and indeed there is an extra kick, an extra recoil. That's maybe not the exact way how you should look at it. You should rather say that when we have the magnetic gradient, the spin up and spin down atoms have a periodic velocity modulation. And if we flip the spin, let's say with that pulse, we have a transfer from an average velocity which is higher to an average velocity which is lower, and therefore there is a momentum kick. So this is shown here again. We see the magnetic shaking, we see the IF pulses. For this selected piece of amplitude, here is a spin flip, and you kind of see that there is an extra kick. But this momentum transfer, the recoil momentum, really depends on how you synchronize the magnetic shaking and the IF pulses. Here I show you the other example where the delta function pulses are shifted by 90 degrees. And now if you look at that, you would say, no, there isn't really an extra kick in this force for a selected trajectory. And indeed, if you also look at the spin-dependent velocity for both states which are coupled, spin up and spin down, is the same, and therefore you're not transferring from a state with an average velocity to a state with a different average velocity. So what I just showed you with these diagrams, you can immediately read from that that we have a recoil. The recoil is a maximum recoil when the phase of the radio frequency of the synchronization pulses is chosen to be zero. For a 90 degree phase shift, there is no recoil. Okay, so this is one property we know if we have an optical transition. An optical transition has recoil, and now I've shown you how we can endow an IF transition with recoil. But there is another aspect, and this is the Doppler shift. Does this IF transition also have a Doppler shift? I could actually ask you, what do you think? Well, there are two answers to it, to make it interesting. One is, normally, when we drive a transition with a photon, the Doppler shift comes from energy conservation. Because if we start in the ground state and have a photon and an initial kinetic energy, and then we have an excited state with possibly a different velocity, but if the different velocity is shifted by a recoil, then the resonance frequency is not the naked, the bare resonance frequency. There is a Doppler shift and recoil shift. So you would say, if you have a momentum transfer, you need a Doppler shift due to energy conservation. However, is energy conserved? We have time-dependent magnetic fields. For time-dependent Hamiltonian, you cannot generally assume that energy is conserved. And indeed, let's assume we would have a pi pulse. So we would have atoms in spin up, and with a pi pulse, we would switch them to spin down. At that situation, we would transfer momentum because the average velocity has changed. But in this case, the resonant frequency for the pi pulse would be the atomic frequency, and therefore the extra kinetic energy which appears here will not come from the IF photon, it will come from the time-dependent magnetic fields. So the energy in this case comes from the time-dependent magnetic field. However, for the situation I introduced to you with many weak pulses synchronized with the oscillating magnetic field gradient, as I want to show you now, there is indeed a Doppler shift. The correct way to look at this situation is, well, if you have many pulses, you should look at it as a multi-pulse Ramsey sequence, and you should ask, what is the phase evolution between the two pulses? And the phase evolution between the two pulses is, well, it's phase evolution in free space. Therefore, the phase evolution is the time averaged kinetic energy. And I mentioned to you is that the velocity in spin up and spin down is different during the shaking. So therefore, a superposition state of spin up and spin down accrues a phase shift due to the different kinetic energy. And this phase shift can be written as kV times the pulse time. And indeed, what you find out now is, if you want to compensate for the phase shift between the two pulses by a detuning of the radio frequency, you have to detune by the Doppler shift. So therefore, in this case, with this scheme of alternating magnetic forces and IF pulses, there's also a Doppler shift. You can nicely illustrate that on the Bloch sphere. If you start with a spin-up atom and you would have the frequency on resonance, the detuning, the differential phase accumulated due to the different kinetic energy would mean that you're not in resonance, you have phase shift and you never go from the North Pole to the South Pole. But if you detune by the Doppler shift, you will eventually have Rabi oscillations between North and South Pole. Now let me contrast it to the other phase I mentioned. If we phase shift the IF pulses by 90 degrees, then there is no average in kinetic energies, there is no Doppler shift, there is sort of nothing happening, and independent of velocity, we have Rabi oscillations without Doppler shift, without recoil. So let me summarize what I've told you so far. So if you have an alternating magnetic force, you have a series of RF pulses. They together can be described by a radio frequency photon, which has an adjustable recoil. The maximum recoil is given by the momentum transfer during half a cycle of the magnetic force period. And the sign and the magnitude of the recoil depends on the phase shift between the RF pulses and the magnetic forces. Okay, 5 more minutes, yeah, perfect. So, of course, what I showed you with in terms of a Ramsey picture, in terms of a trajectory picture, can also be formalized by using Floquet theory, the different ways of applying Floquet theory. I'm referring here to one framework of Nathan Goldman and Jean Dalibard, where they show that the time evolution operator during an alternating Floquet scheme can be separated into a micromotion or kick operator and an effective Hamiltonian. And if you insert this pulse sequence, you find indeed an effective Hamiltonian, which looks like the effective Hamiltonian of a photon, because it has e to the I kz, it has a wave vector on the off diagonal. So therefore, from this formalism, it's clear that the physical picture I derived for you is correct, because this Hamiltonian has both recoil, Doppler shift, it has everything you want to see. It has everything we know when we have a photon which transfers momentum. Actually, it's interesting, the only difference is there is a small extra term, and this is nothing else than the kinetic energy of the micromotion. Okay, we realized this system. We used an ultra-cold cloud of sodium just above Bose-Einstein condensation, used an M equals 0 and M equals 1 state, coupled at 8 megahertz, and we had a shaking with 100 Gauss per centimeter at frequencies between 5 and 10 kilohertz. So what you see here is the time of light picture of the atoms after the RF transfer without shaking, and this is just we transfer part of the cloud to the other RF state. But if we do the shaking, we actually select as a thinner slice in velocity space. And so this shows that we have now velocity selection due to the Doppler shift. We can have different frequency detunings, and you see here that for one detuning you are in resonance with the left part or with the right part of the velocity distribution. And if we determine as a function of frequency which is the central velocity for which we have a spin flip, you indeed find that there is a Doppler shift, and the Doppler shift agrees with the calibration of the magnetic gradient. Now, this is for one phase of the RF. If we now change the phase of the RF pulses by 180 degrees, the sign of the photon recoil flips, so the recoil momentum flips over, and we see the opposite Doppler shift. So let me come back to spin orbit coupling. So what I've shown you is that we have Floquet engineered an RF photon, it has now recoil, so therefore it is equivalent to this spin flip transition, which until now was implemented with a 2-photon Raman transition. If we do a canonical transformation of this Hamiltonian, it can be written in this way, and this is the way how we have often written down the Hamiltonian for spin-orbit coupling, and what you see here is it has the form P minus A, so there is a spin-dependent gauge potential. Whenever you introduce a gauge potential, you have actually two momenta. You have a kinetic momentum and you have a canonical momentum, and they differ by the gauge potential. It is very pedagogical for this shaking scheme that you can directly associate a physical quantity which can be measured with both the canonical and the kinetic momentum. The kinetic momentum is nothing else than the time-averaged momentum, but the canonical momentum is the momentary momentum at the moment of the IF transfer. And this is useful. It's, there's always a reason why you introduce canonical momentum. And canonical momentum is useful because the momentum at the moment of the IF transfer, of course, has to be the same for spin up and spin down because the IF has no momentum and couples two momentum states in spin up and spin down, which are equal. So if I introduce the canonical momentum as the momentary momentum at the IF transfer, we can now plot the energy versus momentum in this way. And in this diagram, which is the standard diagram for spin-orbit coupling, because it's plotted versus canonical momentum, all the IF transitions are now vertical. And if you look at those dashed arrows, these are the different vertical IF transitions. Those arrows have different lengths, but this is just the Doppler shift I was talking about. Okay, spin-orbit coupling, there were suggestions in the literature how to do spin-orbit coupling in one and two dimensions. I just give credit here to the people who did it. There is one last thing I want to discuss, and this was, there were some recent publications where they did actually an experiment similar to ours, just without IF pulses. There was just a magnetic shaking, and the authors claimed that with that they had realized spin-orbit coupling. My interpretation is that this is actually highly ambiguous, because if you use the framework with the time evolution operator, pure magnetic shaking is not modifying the effective Hamiltonian. The effective Hamiltonian is the free particle Hamiltonian, and pure magnetic shaking is only creating a kick operator or micromotion operator. Or in other words, I showed you today that the vector potential or the gauge potential is proportional to the recoil, which depends on the phase of the IF. So if you have no IF, you have a not well-defined phase, and therefore everything is ambiguous. Okay, we had some experimental challenges because if you have magnetic shaking and then want to observe Doppler effects of a few hundred hertz, you need really very good field stability. And maybe the rest shouldn't be the subject of a talk, it's more the subject for supplemental information in the paper. We had a stainless steel chamber and we had eddy currents, and the eddy currents affected both the radio frequency and also modified the magnetic fields, the time-dependent magnetic fields we put on. And it was a major problem to first understand them and then account for them. Anyway, the conclusion is radio frequency photons can have recoil momentum and can behave like optical photons thanks to Floquet engineering. And what we observed is that using magnetic forces, we have enhanced the recoil of an IF photon by a factor of 6 million, and we could flip the sign of the recoil by changing the phase. So let me conclude by thanking my collaborators and the funding agencies.
Thank you.